Ben Washburn, welcome to Mormon Stories Podcast.
Hey, thank you for having me on Mormon Stories Podcast. Glad to be here.
It's my pleasure. You know, it may come as a surprise to you, but there might be one or two people in my listening audience who have actually not heard of you before. So let me brag about you for just a second, okay?
Oh, sweet. I love this. Yes. Cool.
All right. As I look on your website, which is getbent.com or bent.com, I guess we should start out by clarifying how you spell your name. Tell us how you spell your name.
B-E-N-G-T.
G-T.
Swedish.
And the G is?
It's silent.
It's silent.
Which is so how I get my street name. Silent
right.
G. Yeah.
You have a lot of cred, street cred, right?
Yeah.
So getbent.com with the G, B-E-N-G-T.
Yeah.
It says that you've appeared on television.
Yeah.
On The Late Show, The Late Late Show with Craig Ferguson. That's pretty swanky.
Yeah.
Live at Gotham at Comedy Central.
Yeah.
Looks like you've been on several radio shows.
Yeah.
All of which I've never heard of before, except for Public Radio International and NPR.
Yeah, yeah. And CBC, well, I was just on the Canadian Broadcasting.
Did you throw in a gratuitous a boat?
Several. A boat and A's. Yeah.
It also says here that you were the winner of the San Francisco International Comedy Competition. You know, the Vancouver International Comedy Festival. You performed at the 2002 Winter Olympics, performed for the U.S. troops in Iraq.
Yeah.
You've performed at a lot of corporate gigs like Marriott and Blue Cross Blue Shield and Frito-Lay, Home Depot.
Yeah.
Yada, yada, yada.
Just a comic. I'm a comic.
Are you the most famous LDS comic that there's ever been?
No, I think, I wonder, has there been any, are there... I know a couple others. There's Ryan Hamilton, and he was on Live at Gotham, and he was on Last Comic Standing, and he advanced a little bit.
Okay.
So maybe he's more famous than me, even.
Except I've never heard of him, so,
yeah,
you know, he fails the John DeLynn test.
Yeah, there you go, right there. He, he lives in New York, and he was actually named 2 years ago by Rolling Stone magazine Top 10 Comic to Watch.
Okay.
So there's one, and
he's your nemesis.
My nemesis. He's my buddy, actually. He's really funny. He's super clean, unlike me. He's squeaky clean comedy. And a very active Mormon, unlike me. I got to admit.
Unlike. Well, you're scaring off our audience before you even begin.
I'm sorry. Or bringing them in, I think.
That's true.
Yeah.
Well, let's get to you without any further ado.
Okay.
You're a comedian.
Yeah, stand-up comedian.
Let's go way back. Let's talk about the ways in which your parents messed you up to the point where you would want to become a comedian.
That's a very good guess. Accurate. Well done. I don't know if they messed me up. There were seven kids. That might have something to do with it. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Four older brothers, two younger sisters. So I was like in the exact wrong place in the line of siblings, if you think about it. I mean, that means four older boys picking on me, and then I got two younger sisters who I can't really pick on, I guess you could say. You know what I mean?
Sure.
And I'm always getting a beating, and I can't give one out. That's what
kind of sandwiched by brutality.
Yes. Yeah.
In Mapleton, Utah.
Mapleton, Utah. Little tiny town there.
Is that south of Provo?
South of Provo, just right off of Springville, up in the mountains. My dad's a psychiatrist, or he was.
Where did he train?
University of Utah. It's where he went to medical school. He met my mom at BYU. I think they met at BYU. Did he go to BYU? My dad wasn't, he converted to Mormonism. Even though I grew up in a little town in Utah, Monroe, Utah, I converted. So when he met my mom, they met at a dance. This is kind of interesting. They both had polio, and they met at a dance. So there's probably something there.
Did they, were they like FDR? Did they have canes or braces?
A bit of a limp and that kind of stuff and difficulty. All I'm saying is if everybody got up to dance, there's a good chance they'd be the two sitting there and like, oh, hi, how are you? Yeah, I don't dance either. Why? Well, because I kind of can't very well. You know what I mean? I don't know how it went down. I just know they both are survivors of polio. You were asking me, what did my parents do?
Yeah, so...
to mess you up, that you would be a comic.
So aside from being sandwiched between two genders of brutality...
I think the idealism, I read a book, Story, what's that guy named, McClellan or McKean? He was talking about comedians, and he said they're the disillusioned idealists, and I think that's true. You know what I mean? A lot of comedians are these, they were idealists at one point, and then it falls apart, and I think there's a lot of comedy in there. And of course,
I've heard that a skeptic is an idealist who's been burned.
That makes sense. That makes total sense. Well, and I was raised idealist. I don't know if it was the personality or the culture or my personality in the culture. But growing up Mormon, I took it all very seriously as a young child.
I should tell you this. I grew up my childhood here in Utah. I grew up in Utah. Anybody else grew up in Utah here? All right. Which is good. It's not that weird. People think it's very weird. It's not. Growing up Mormon, not any weirder than growing up Amish or, shit, that should have been a big joke. Like half of your, that's about right. You learn, you really don't know about yourself until you leave home. You know what I mean? That's the way life works. Like, I didn't know really who I was until I turned 19. They gave me a suit and a 10-speed bike. Because I grew up in Utah, and they gave me the bike, and I went on my Mormon mission. And that's when I found out that people thought we were weird. You know what I mean? I had no idea until then, because everybody in Mapleton, Utah was like me. They had a basement full of food, and you know what I mean? Not fancy food, right? You just had like a few thousand pounds of wheat and some beans, bottled cherries. We had tons of cherries because... My parents, we lived in a cherry orchard. So we had all that, and then no toilet paper, which was always kind of strange to me, because, you know, you could see the menu. Wheat, fruit, beans, no toilet paper. You worried about the apocalypse? I got a prophecy for you. Shit happens. Yeah. Especially when you like eat cherries and chase it with some wheat. The worst thing about food storage to me was that my mom didn't want to throw it away. That was always the problem. You know what I mean? So that bumper crop of cherries in the 70s, we'd have to eat that before it went bad. That was the thing. My mom, we were always eating stuff before it go bad. You know what I mean? Eat this before it goes bad. If my mom had a restaurant, it would be called Eat This Before It Goes Bad. She'd still do it. You'll show up, here, quick, Ben, eat this before it goes bad. Quick. That little word always, with that phrase, quick. How close is it to bad, Mom? Are we seconds away from critical mass and botulism with the... Hurry. So... You'd have this basement full of cherries from the 70s, and then along come the 80s, go down the basement, get some of those cherries. You got to eat them before they go bad. And then of course, you'd push it too far. You eat a quart of dicey cherries, and everybody's, blah, you know. Then I guess we didn't eat those cherries fast enough. It might be the cherries. Really, Mom? You think it was the cherries from the 70s? Do you think it was the cherries you bottled during Watergate? That have transformed our colons into salad shooters. And that's what happened, Mom? Is that what went down?
But growing up Mormon, I took it all very seriously as a young child.
So pretty devout household. Tell us about the devoutness of the household.
I was very devout, and parents were pretty on and off devout. I always thought they were devout. You know what I mean? You know how when you're a kid, you assume they're devout. And I took all those rules and, I mean, they kept the rules. We had the basement full of year supply. They were serious about the year supply. I remember every Sunday talking about church, lots of family home evenings. And I don't know what it is. They would talk to me about church. They would talk about, I always remember talking about the second coming a lot. That's all I remember. We had a basement full of food, and I was sure that Jesus was going to be back, like, real soon. And I think those stories probably, they really captured my imagination. I mean, I would think about those a lot.
Kind of scared?
Yeah, they would scare me. And I had a very active conscience, had being the operative word. And I was very, I was worried, you know. I always felt a little bit guilty, a little bit scared. And
I'm all for prep. I think it's wise to prepare, but it's not wise to, like, not be ready for today. You know what I mean? Like, I remember when the turn of the century came around, the year 2000, you know all the people that, like, dropped everything? It's like, oh, this is the big one. He is coming. He's going to be here. And they, like, drop out of college, and you know what I mean? They max out their credit cards. And about January 3rd, 2000, aw, dang. Yeah. What do you know? He didn't come when you thought he would. Kind of works out that way sometimes. Have you talked with the Jews? How long have they been waiting around, dipshit? What do you think it's going to... So, I had people, I know people that literally take their kids out of school because they want to keep them pure for when, you know, well, they're not going to need a college education. Jesus will be back. What are you talking, idiot? You know what I mean? Now you're not preparing for something that'll probably happen in order to be prepared for something that probably won't happen. You know what I mean? Why don't you just drop out of college and learn how to paint with your mouth in case you break your neck? Why don't you do that? Let's go to the beach. I didn't take sunblock. I'm counting on an eclipse, I'm pretty sure.
But you're a true believer.
I was absolutely, absolutely a true believer. Yeah. Yeah. Raised and, to do that. And
seminary?
Yeah, well, once I was never very good at doing homework, attending things, if I could get out of it. I did graduate seminary, but barely. But yeah, I went to seminary.
A bit of a slacker?
Bit of a slacker. That's what I was. A dreamer. Sit around.
So you were simultaneously a slacker and a literal believer.
Yes. See, and now you're going to get in trouble. But a slacker. So I guess I was kind of doomed. You know what I mean? I was bound to be disillusioned with as high as... You know, I took things so literally with religion.
So did you have a lot of guilt?
Oh, lots of guilt. Lots of guilt. Especially when I went through puberty. That's when the guilt hit.
Why is that? Why is that?
Suddenly I have this sex drive. I knew nothing about sex. I didn't go to the sex ed talk at school. My mom erroneously figured my dad had told me enough, and I had four older brothers. Maybe she figured they had told me enough. I don't. For whatever reason, she said, oh, you don't need to go to that sex ed class. They had sixth grade, and I didn't go. I was so clueless about sex. I have a bit I do sometimes, but maybe this might be too adult. I don't know. It's kids watch it. Anyway, what happened is I thought that a nocturnal emission was masturbation. And that really messed up my head. It's pretty funny on stage, though, when I talk about that, actually. I know that seems
well,
like it couldn't
be. Go ahead and do your thing.
Well, what happened...
Keep it as clean as is humanly possible, but don't stress about it. Just tell your story.
Okay. So what happens is... how does it go? I thought... Well... I tell people that I learned about sex basically in church because I didn't get to talk in school. We didn't talk about it at home. So the only place we talked about sex was in church. And my sex ed class was Mormon Sunday school. And that's just, and this is what I learned in my sex ed Mormon Sunday school. If you masturbate, you will go to hell. And they said other stuff, but I didn't hear it. You know, I just sat there going, dang it, you know, that's a short ride, you know, but In actuality, I wasn't thinking that. I was thinking, what is masturbation? I didn't know what that was. I literally didn't. It's a big word. I didn't really know what it was. But I run home and I'm looking in the dictionary under masturbation, and I find it, and then I have to look up five more words. You know what I mean? Because it's just this chain reaction to ignorance. And then I finally figure out what it is. Oh, that. But I didn't. Still, I didn't know what it was. I ended up with this confusion in my head that I thought it was a nocturnal emission. I'll cut out the rest of the bit. But I literally was setting my alarm for 2 a.m. so I could wake up and prevent, you know, my, can I say penis? My penis from marching me to hell. I thought it was like, you know, I literally, well, I could stop. Don't do this. This is evil. And
so, I mean, you joke about it, but that's, I mean, I'm studying psychology. I've actually talked to people that suffered pretty severe emotional trauma from the guilt they experienced from this exact scenario that you just described.
Oh, yeah. Oh, no. Very traumatic. Very traumatic. And I mean, this is over a period of how many months and months and months of me not understanding that I'm normal, that I'm not weird, that this is part of the normal function, that God gives you this sex drive. And when I do this, or nature, whatever you may believe, but it's there. And when I do it on stage, there's more facts and it's funnier, it flows better and all that. But I guess it was traumatizing, maybe. I don't know.
So is it weird to do a bit about something in a comedic way that has such deep, painful roots potentially?
It was,
or do you get over it?
I think,
or are you just
it's kinda
compartmentalist?
Yeah, maybe I'm doing that stuff. I don't know. Maybe I'm compartmentalizing, or it's kind of cathartic in a way. I laugh at it. It really is, when it's all put together, a very, very funny bit. And I think it's powerful, and I think there's enough people have gone through that or something similar that it's very truthful and meaningful, and it gives my job meaning. I mean, I feel good about what I'm doing. When I do that bit, I feel good about it. Ironically, I also get many Mormons who tell me I'm going to hell for talking about that. I got just this weekend, someone I'd gone to high school, I got word they think I should clean up my act. And I'm like, okay, I got you. Don't talk about this stuff because that's so healthy, you know?
Yeah. So this bit that you do, now you've got me wanting to hear it. Is there some place we could access it, or do I just need to tell you to do it?
I didn't do it on that show, did I? I didn't do that bit. Dang it.
Do you remember it?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Let's do it, and then if we have to put it in post-production.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. I grew up very sexually repressed. I mean, Mapleton, Utah. They would not even put out the condoms out at the store. You know how you go to the store and the condoms would be back, like behind the counter. They said teenagers would steal them, which of course is, yeah, right. You lose a few condoms. So how about an unwanted pregnancy? How expensive is that? But they hide them. And I think they hid the condoms because they're afraid teenagers would find the condoms, get all excited and curious about sex, right? Of course, I was already excited and curious about sex because I had a penis, you know. Like, the sight of a condom is going to suddenly remind a 13-year-old boy about this constant boner, you know? Like, wow, I hadn't thought about you in seconds. So they hide the condoms, but then every spring, pregnancies, of course. Wherever you have people, pregnancies, that's the way it's supposed to work, you know? And then the whole town, what happened? What went wrong? Well, Satan is so powerful, you know, I bet you the Gina condom. You know, just this. So hide. Yeah, they hide the condom. Saying condoms makes teenagers have sex is like saying the headlights on my car make the sun go down. You know, it's that logical. Say hide the condoms every spring. Now, I don't think teenagers should have condoms. I should have sex. Don't get me wrong. I don't think they should have sex. I don't think the little poop should drive. You know what I mean? I don't think teenagers should operate vehicles or genitalia. I don't even think they should own genitalia. It's one of those things that make you doubt in God. You know, the world, You see things in the world, you're like, how could there be a God with that? You know, like poverty and war and astroturf. How could there be a God? And that's teenagers with genitalia is one of these things. Like, how could an all-knowing God give the teenager the baby-making equipment? That makes people. How would you put the teenagers, there you go, kids, knock yourself up. I mean, out, go. Just insane. So I don't think teenagers should have sex, but why not give them condoms, right? And I'll tell this to people, like, well, I think the condoms should just be out there and available. And they'll, oh, but then you're telling them to have sex, Ben. No, no, I'm not. If I give someone a condom, I'm not saying have sex. I'm saying I wish you were sterile, right? That's what I'm saying. I wish nothing worked. But you're a teenager, and I know you've got all the restraint of a hypochondriac with health insurance. So here's a condom. So I don't think teenagers should have sex, but you should put out the condoms. And the reason I'm passionate about this is because I'm passionate about the idea of tell your teenagers what is going on. You know, tell them about sex, put the condoms out there, be honest about the situation they're in, which is God has given them this equipment. It feels amazingly good to use it. You know what I mean? And that's part of the plan. He's just trying to fool you into making people. You know, he is. I mean, first he said, make people, and then no one was making them. And then so he made it feel amazing. Sex is that way. Sex is like, wow, this cake is delicious. Crap, a person. That's sex. That's what sex, that's the whole plan of God. Apparently, or nature. You know what I mean? I mean, he was... It has to be, if you think about it, that, well, for instance, after a blackout, if you have a blackout in a city, what happens 9 months later? Phew, you have a little spike in birth because we weren't conceived in love. We were conceived in boredom, a lot of us, you know? It's like, what are we going to do? So anyway, I'm passionate about the telling kids about sex, warning them, because I never got a sex talk. Not a word about sex in the house. 7 kids in the family. So sex was happening. 7 kids in like 10 years. There were 5 teenage boys in our house at one time. 5. How do you not talk about sex with 5 teenage boys? Every morning there are 5 boners at the breakfast table. Can I say that? You know, the darn thing's floating like we're holding a seance. You know, is that too far? Did I? And then no one's saying a word about it. As a result of this, I was blindsided by puberty. Nobody even told me that puberty was coming. You know what I mean? How about a little practical prophecy here? You know what I mean? I mean, all this word about Jesus is coming any day. You guess I won't, that's dirty. But anyway, you see what I'm saying? You see what I'm saying? Guess who else is going to be? And just not a word. And as a result, I was blindsided by puberty. And for a guy, I don't know about women, but for a guy, puberty is a personal Armageddon. I mean, that really is. Your life changes completely. Before puberty, it's all fun and la la, and then suddenly you wake up. Can I say asshole? Is that, there's an asshole in your head. There really is. And he's just, ooh, look at that, look at her, look at her. It won't shut up. Look at her, look at her. No, no. Look at her. She's our cousin. So, second cousin. You know, just. And so that's, I became just, I knew nothing about sex. The only time I heard about sex was at church. That was it. Was in church, and that's wrong. I got my sex talk in church. That's what I learned in Mormon Sunday School sex talk. If you masturbate, you will go to hell. Then they said other things, but none of the boys heard anything. We just sat there like, you know, that was a short ride. Now, actually, I wasn't saying that. I was saying, what is masturbate? Because I didn't know. I had had no sex. I knew nothing about it. So I run home. I look up masturbate in the dictionary. Then I have to look up like 5 more words, a chain reaction of ignorance. I don't know what I'm looking at. Then I figure out what that is. Then I look it up in the Bible. And I love the Bible's beautiful. Book of Mormon, these are beautiful scriptures. They are horrible sex manuals, horrible, especially the Old Testament. I do not look up anything on sex in the Old Testament. Masturbation, if you looked it up in the Bible, in the Old Testament, self-abuse. That's just confusing to a 13. Self-abuse, it didn't seem to hurt. You know, this is insane. Or spilling your seed. That's the other lingo. Spilling. And I actually like that one because then it's an accident. You know, like, oops, did I do that? It was my bad. Was that? So I look up all these scriptures and I don't know what it is, you know. So now I Well, I haven't done this bit for a while, but basically what I end up is this place where I am literally, I think I'm going to hell in my sleep. What I'm saying is I should have known the difference. I would have liked to have known the difference, just what sex was, and they should have told me clearly what masturbation was. Just up, this is what it is. I would have liked to known what it was. If it's a sin, I should know. And I should definitely know the difference between, say, masturbation and a nocturnal emission, because I didn't know. And that's how it happened. Now, I thought I was masturbating in my sleep. I thought somehow I was possessed down there and it was just marching me to hell. So I was setting my alarm for 2 a.m. so I could wake up every and then wake up and stop my penis from marching me to hell. Just stop. And I remember literally, yes, what are you doing? Yelling at, my crotch. This is wrong. This is evil. That went on for months. And then I remember finally after a bishop interview, I never forget the look on a poor bishop's face. Well, he's a kind man. And then it becomes apparent in the process of this horrible, horrifying event for me, this confession, it becomes apparent that I think this nocturnal thing is masturbation. And the look on his face of just, and then am I reading this right? Have I been going, I remember leaving relieved, so I can go on a mission. Okay, But I mean, I literally think my entire life is, in going. That was really, that was quite a traumatic experience.
Traumatized. So you went on a mission.
Yeah, I went on a mission.
So when I left home as a missionary, that's when I found out that some people thought coffee evil weird. This is when I really knew that we were different. I'm out knocking on the doors like you do. I'm pedaling. One day we go pedal into a neighborhood, and in this cul-de-sac, big neighborhood, there are Jehovah Witnesses coming out. And if you've been more missionary, you know that happens. We were in Seattle. It happened. So there they are. The Jehovah Witnesses coming out. We're going in. And our eyes meet, and we bond instantly. Do you know what I mean? We formed this kind of brotherhood of suffering, I know you. You know what I mean? And it was us. There's other people around, but we we're the same. Kind of like when dogs see each other in a crowd of people. We're kind of alike. We were doing that. Not that we're dogs, but we're different. But this is when I really knew I was different. So I see them, and I'm doing that thing. Yeah, we're the same. We are, except you're wrong. And then I pedal. And then... This is where I still didn't understand what that meant, that meant we were weird. Because then we pedal into the cul-de-sac, not realizing that they have screwed up the fishing hall. How could we not get that, And then you knock on the door, we told you to go away. We're not like, yeah, you're all the same. Shit. They think we're like those freaks. Yeah, they do. And
Yeah, I went on a mission.
What was that like?
That was really hard. It's hard, but I went to Seattle, Spanish speaking. And that was, so that means I went to Seattle Spanish speaking, which means I didn't speak very good Spanish, of course. But it was hard. I was a true believer, which makes it, I think, even, I don't know, what's harder, to go on a mission and not believe or to go on a mission and believe? I mean, again, I had a very active, take responsibility and the guilt feeling and all that kind of stuff. One of the things I remember them telling me on the mission that I still to this day, they used to tell us, you are responsible for all the people in your area. They're not going to go to heaven. That was my impression. They couldn't get to heaven. There was people's souls dependent on my worthiness and my effort. That's what you're told, And, I took that pretty seriously, but then that's when it started to, there's a part of me, especially as I started to meet other missionaries, I was like, surely God isn't going to send all the people in Renton to hell just because these two jackasses, You know what I mean? I was trying, but I'd meet other missionaries where I was like, no way would, no, could God, no, he wouldn't do that, surely. But it was, mission's hard.
Did you have any success?
Yeah, because Spanish speaking. And, you know, they'll let you in and they're looking for something and they want to be more American. Maybe that's it, I don't know, but we had some success. And the mission is really when, I know the mission they send you out to convert people. Is it to convert people or to convert yourself? I don't know, but for me it was, well, it was the first time I'd really left home, so there's that whole aspect of, wow, big buildings and, you know, just, well, it's the first time I'm leaving Utah. I'd gone to Disneyland a few times, so I had seen some minorities, but not this many, and not every day, you know, and talk to them and interact with them. And then there's the companions you would have from other parts of the country, you know, from the East, and some of the companions who were not true believers, who were very definitely not true believers, who were going out for their parents, who were just, you know, they were doing, you know, 2 years to just try to avoid shame is why they were out there. And I understood that.
Did you have any leadership? Were you in any leadership positions on your mission?
I was a district leader and then I was a zone leader. But by the time I was a zone leader, I think there'd been this process of where I was starting to think that some of the details were, for lack of a better word, bullshit. Some of the details, you know, little yellow planners and, well, you got to do 60 hours and all this kind of, you know, knock this many doors, give out this many Book of Mormons. And I started to see that what I felt was a poisoning of religion, and it happens in all religion, not just Mormonism, but where vanity enters into the religion and, you know, the Sadducee and the Pharisee, that kind of, I started to really see that, and that really bothered me.
All the rules.
Yeah, the rules, and then people who enjoyed keeping the rules and enjoyed keeping more of the rules than you, and that's what bothered me. That very thing. I mean, in my opinion, that's what Jesus hated when he came back, was that. And I started to see that. And it wasn't everybody. There were wonderful, devout Mormons. And then there were those that, ugh.
Did you ever have any profound spiritual experiences on your mission?
You know, I don't know. I could never trust those things, you know? Was that something I made? Was that, because I've had spiritual experiences walking in the woods, or, you know, or looking at a painting or listening to music, and so it was hard for me to separate out those feelings. I definitely had a profound conversion to some of the stories within Mormonism, the ideas, the basic ideas, the myths. They're very powerful and beautiful to me.
Did you help others, you know, get converted or have those types of experiences?
Yeah, we did.
You saw other people convert and lives changed and positive
things?
Yes,
they did. Saw some people from Peru, and this woman, she converted, and then her daughter converted, and her daughter was a missionary and was so obviously very, very happy with what she was doing. And then there was a young man that we baptized that was definitely a spiritual experience. I mean, it was for him, I mean, there's no question, a life-changing, incredibly spiritual experience. And what a great guy. I can't even remember his name. Jeez. But
he was changed?
He was changed. Or, you know what, I think more so, he was really looking to change. I mean, I give him more credit, you know, in that process. It wasn't just Mormonism. It was him too. But he was a wonderful guy. And he had met, it's kind of like, I remember I thinking kind of my dad, because my dad met my mom and then converted to Mormonism. And yeah, this guy met a woman, and you're always wary of that, you know?
Sure.
But not in this case. I wasn't at all wary. And there were two cases of that. There's another one where a guy met the woman, and he was converting, and she left the church right after he converted, and he was completely converted. He really, I mean, this was something, you know, sincere and real for him. Very nice guy as well.
So what'd you do when you got home?
I got home from a mission. I went to school, and I decided to study art.
Tell us where. Tell us where.
Utah
it's very
State
important.
University. Actually, first I went to Brigham Young University for one semester. And I remember I went over to get my student ID, and it was right after the first semester to end the second semester. And there was a guy standing at the door with a short white sleeve shirt and a tie and a haircut and stern looking, you know, middle-aged guy. And as I approached the door, he just literally just stepped in front of me and in a horrible way. So you think you're going to go in there like looking like that? You can just turn right around. Like this sense that there was something in this person, me, that needed to be beat down. And he was so wrong. He was so wrong about who I was. And it just disgusted me to the core. Disgusted me, that man did. And the abuse of power. And the soul lack of, just so out of touch with what gospel is and what Mormonism is and what Christianity is and what Christ is. I mean, how much fear do you have of the world that you think you have to go around micromanaging humans like this? And I remember turning around that day and going, I am not coming back here. That was just awful. And I had a
brother. That was what led you to leave after one semester?
Absolutely. Yeah, I couldn't. It made me livid, just sick. And I just thought, I don't want to stay here. Well, plus my parents, I could leave home if I went to Utah State. Not live at home. But no, that was very much a large part of it. It's just I knew that if I stayed in this environment, that wasn't going to be a singular event. You know, I knew that, well, this is just going to happen again and again, and this will just get ugly and nasty. I'll just leave, and then I'll be a happier person, and they'll be happier. I mean, that guy won't be happier. He needs people like me to police, you know? So he can go home and say, well, I cleaned the world today, whatever.
So you transferred to Zion.
Yeah, I transferred to Zion, to Utah State University. I had a brother up there, too, and he said, oh, this is fun. You'll love it up here. And I heard Utah State had a good art program, and I decided to go into painting. Drawing, fine art. I'd always wanted to do comedy. I really had always wanted to be a comedian. But it did not seem compatible with being a Mormon. And I was so naive, I thought that fine art would be. Because I knew nothing about fine art. I didn't know that there were guys that moment in New York, you know, squirting blue paint into their colons and pooping it out on canvases. I didn't know that was going on in fine art. I was so naive. But I went to Utah State because they had a really good art program. So did BYU. But
so as a child, you wanted to be a comedian?
I really did. I used to run around with joke books and tell jokes. I did a routine in high school. I wrote my own little routine. I did a stand-up routine for an assembly. And it crushed. Well, I thought, I don't know if it was crushed or not. It seemed to do
it. Is that good to crush?
To crush is good.
Okay.
And I really
do you remember a joke or two from that original routine? Oh.
I remember it was influenced by George Carlin, by like a 5-minute bit of Carlin. Oh, that's the only Carlin I ever got to hear. My parents did not. I never got to be truly influenced by Carlin, and that's a shame. But yeah, I remember it was something. I did a character. I put on a costume. And there's something with Rice Krispies, and they were my pets, and it was really dumb. It's really dumb, stupid, but high school kids, you know, they're not dumb. They just laugh at dumb things.
But you crushed.
It did. It went really well, yeah. I probably didn't, but to me it was, wow, this great.
So were you always telling jokes at home and yeah. annoying your siblings and your parents?
Yeah. Yeah, I had a joke book that I would read and carry around and tell the jokes. Horrible.
Were you nerdy or cool?
I don't know what I was. I was always an outsider, very much so. Even though I had lots of friends, I only had one close friend all through high school. That's it. I didn't like the obligations of friendship. It felt like I was always being asked to give up an opinion or who I was, you know what I mean, to be liked. So I would be kind of lightly friendly to everybody. I wasn't unpopular by any means, but I was kind of an outsider, I think, and an odd one. I was an oddball.
Would you practice your jokes in front of a mirror?
Yes. Lots. I used to just sit and make faces in front of mirrors for hours and do jokes. I don't know.
You know, there must be a comedy gene, because this sounds like Jim Carrey's childhood. This sounds like Steve Martin's childhood. I mean,
no.
There must be a comedy gene. This is as genetic as any other human condition.
I think there's genetics in there. Absolutely. No, I do. My son goofs off in front of the mirror. It's heartbreaking to see. I mean, because I'm a comedian. I'm like, oh, you don't know that this is just horrible. And I tell, every time people say, I want to be a comic, the first thing I tell them, and any advice, young comics, I'll say, my advice is if you can quit, quit. Seriously, if you can, just quit. But it's like you say, I think the genes, and you get hooked, you become obsessed with the process, and it's horrible.
So who are your early influences?
Jonathan Winters. When I was a kid, we'd watch Jonathan Winters and Tim Conway and Carol Burnett and Harvey Korman. That's pretty much all I saw. And then listened to Bill Cosby, of course, and amazing. And then Steve Martin. When he first came on TV, my parents thought he was a clean comic, because that's how out of touch we were with the world.
You know? He kind of was, wasn't he?
Well, he was on TV, but his act at times was kind of dirty, but by Mormon standards, very dirty. I mean, I run into that now. I mean, I was told just this last weekend that I really should clean it up. That's the word I got. And then I had that very night. It's so nice to listen to a comic who can be clean and funny. I mean, the standards are just, so Steve Martin, yeah, he was pretty clean. But my dad thought he was squeaky clean, and he bought the Wild and Crazy Guy, or Let's Get Small, and Steve Martin Wild and Crazy Guy albums, but he didn't listen to them with us. So we're listening to these albums, and I was too young. Again, I don't know what a rubber is. So when Steve Martin sings, Grandpa's got a rubber, you know, I don't even know that's dirty. And I didn't even get, there's another reference to female parts and all this stuff. I didn't even get it. I didn't even know that was dirty. I was just laughing. This is funny, you know. So I bring my dad in. Dad, you got to hear this. Meanwhile, my brothers had carefully made sure that my dad did not hear the Steve Martin record. But I bring him in and, listen, Dad, and also, Grandpa bought a rubber. My dad just what? Lori, this isn't clean. This, he just sang it. And then the next joke comes in. He stands up and rip, you know, that, never saw the albums again. Never saw them again.
Big scratch.
Done. They disappeared. They're snap, gone, done.
Did you ever find yourself writing jokes about your experience in church as a teenager? Like collecting material, church material?
I didn't. I really didn't. I mean, this is something you didn't joke about. My goodness. Absolutely not. You know, when Mormons go blue, it's all poopy farty, poopy poop farty, because that's all you can do, you know, is poop jokes. I remember when I first hit the road, I had lots of poop jokes, and they're very clever. I was proud of some of them. And then I remember a few years later, one of the comics on me said, yeah, you used to tell a lot of poop jokes. It's just, well, that's because I was blue Mormon comic.
Yeah. So in college, you studied fine arts.
Yeah, painting. Yeah.
Which came first, your struggles with your faith or your development as a comic?
Oh, that's a good question.
And were they related at all, or were they parallel?
Oh, I think they were related. Absolutely.
So talk about talk about the progression between those two as they interacted.
I think, first of all, I studied fine art, and I really wasn't doing, I did comedy once or twice in college for contests or whatever. Because I did not feel it was compatible, again, with Mormon faith, that you couldn't do this. So I'm doing fine art, but then I went to graduate school, fine art graduate school, and I really started to take my fine art very seriously. And I think that's really where I'm starting to question and wonder, you know, about literal interpretations in Mormonism. And I think it was staring at that blank canvas, you know, and asking me, what do I want to paint? Which turns into the question, what do I want? Which was really the question, who am I? I mean, fine art is a really, it forces you to question. And that's really where the faith started getting questioned, when I was painting in the studio alone for hours and failing miserably.
So oil paints or watercolor?
Oil paint and drawing, that kind of stuff.
And where were you getting your master's?
Indiana University.
That must have been a culture shock.
It was, because then I leave Utah and I go into this small class at Indiana University with all these other graduate students, none of them Mormon, all of them worldly, I mean, very worldly. To me, you know, not just drinking, but drugs and sex and this whole world of experience. I don't even swear. They would comment that. We had a ping pong table, every grad school does probably. We're playing ping pong, and I remember seeing rats when I'd miss, and them like, what? What did you say, rats? I mean, it was a whole other world, yeah. But that's when I started to question, I think, really. And again,
go ahead. Were there fellow students who were gay?
I wonder if we had any gay students in my class.
What year were you at USU and then in graduate school?
I was at USU from 1986 to 1990, I believe, and then 91 to 93 at grad school. I knew gay people at Utah State, yeah. But they came out to me like my last year in college where they said, I'm gay, but I don't know.
That's kind of in the late 80s, that's not a small deal to come out as gay in Utah.
That's a big deal, yeah.
Yeah.
That's not an easy thing. And it was the late 80s.
So talk more about your time with your MFA and what that led to.
I think as when I was studying art, as I said, it just leads to this kind of deep introspection. And then I'm away from home. And I'm painting every week, you know, and I start not going to church. None of my friends are going to church. I mean, my friends were really these artists. You know, that becomes my peer group and the people I share concern in a life and a world with. And then you go to church and you just really feel you're not on the same page with people culturally. I mean, we really don't value the same things. I mean, one of the big things I really became obsessed with was how, to me as a fine artist, beauty was a mystery. But to Mormon culture, beauty was definitely not a mystery. Beauty was, we knew what was beautiful. And these are the things that are beautiful, and if you can execute a depiction of what is beautiful in a, you know, you see what I'm saying? It's not a mystery. And so you don't feel like you have as much in common more and more and more. The more I go into fine art, the less I have in common with these people around me, and the more I have in common with these 7 or 8 friends in grad school. And that was very hard on the marriage. I was married to temple marriage at that time, and it was very hard on our marriage too, to go through the poverty and the struggle and the, you know, being a male Mormon who doesn't make money. That's an awful pressure on your gender roles, both for you and your spouse. And we got married so young anyway, and the divorce, I think, was a... when I came home to Utah from my fine arts career, or not my fine arts career, but my fine arts MFA, I came back to Utah. And I started trying to pursue a fine art career here. I'm painting constantly and taking slides and submitting for teaching positions, but I just couldn't quite get that job. And I just couldn't get the teaching job. And then I started doing comedy on the side as a hobby again. I'd done it for 1 year, open mic, before I went to grad school. And then I went to grad school, I said, I gotta stop this. This comedy isn't compatible, it's wrong. Do your art. Then when I came home, I started doing it again as a hobby, and I had more success with comedy than art. I mean, no one was buying my paintings. I got in good shows even. I was in one of these shows at the Salt Lake Arts Center that they do every year for the Visual Arts Grants Fellowship, whatever it is. And that was a tough show to get into, but it never translated into money. And I started doing comedy at the same time my activity in the church and some of my faith was waning. And I think comedy was therapeutic. As that crumbled and as the marriage crumbled, that was just all material and fire for comedy, and of course.
So was your faith crisis and your feelings about the church the early substance of your joke material?
It was in there, definitely, a little of it, but not that much. I really kept it more personal. But so early on, things, I was a very clean comic, very, very clean. Like I said, a poo-poo pee-pee. And I mostly told jokes. It was all on the surface, and I was coming from a character. I was coming from a character, and a lot of these religious topics, I really wasn't even touching on. I wasn't. Every once in a while, I'd do a few jokes that would come into play. A few. I remember I specifically did have one about gay clubs in Utah. I remember I had a joke about how some young woman, she was lesbian, and she wanted to start a gay club in Utah. I don't know if you guys ever remember this, but.
I remember, this is about 10 years ago, maybe even 15 years ago now. So when I first started doing stand-up, I had a bit about this, but it's true. There was a high school student, and she wanted to start a gay club because she was gay, and she printed up some flyers and handed them up at school, and holy shit. People went nuts, and there was a news story, and they had a woman on the news waving this pamphlet. So we are very concerned about possible recruiting activities. And in my head, I remember thinking, recruiting? Wow, I thought my Mormon mission was tough work, but pamphlet, I mean, that's, you see what I mean? Straight guys, where are you? Okay, could somebody talk you into having sex with another guy? Even if it's a really good pamphlet, like a full color centerfold pop-up diagram thingy. And well, it used to be straight, but then I read your pamphlet. And wouldn't you just get a hold of a lesbian pamphlet and go right back? I would. Although high school kids, I understand, they're very malleable. They can get talked into shit. But if your son is talked into that, his problem isn't he's gay. His problem is he is freaking spineless. That's his problem. He needs to learn how to say no. And then they'd be my friend if I had sex with them. Holy shit. You're in for a hard life. You're gonna change your long distance in religion every week, buddy. Okay.
If it's a really good pamphlet, and then it was like, so I had a joke that, and it worked great. And that was about as racy as I would get, which is actually pretty edgy for Utah because you're questioning this thing. But that's about as, it's probably as racy as I got the most time.
So how do you build a local, you know, university or comedy club career into something that crosses state lines and even goes national?
Well, you gotta have absolutely no business sense, and you have to have nothing to lose. I mean, I had nothing to lose. I got a divorce, and after that divorce, I had my car, my guitar, some clothes. I mean, I had nothing, and nothing to lose at that point. And I had been doing comedy as a hobby, and I just decided, I'm going to do this, and I'm just going to do this now. It's almost like I felt free. I was at rock bottom, and my faith wasn't shattered, and I still feel like I have a lot of faith, but a lot of it was, you know, a bit of a mess. So that was kind of, it's like I didn't feel restrained by my Mormon upbringing at all now. In fact, I felt like I had something to say, you know, and I wasn't worried about it. I said, I'm going to do this. And that's the first thing you have to be able to do is live on next to nothing, because when you start a stand-up comedy career for the first at least 2 or 3 years, you're going to be making at the most, say, $18,000 a year. At the most.
Wow.
At the most. And you're going to be, that's if you can get the work together and you are working these kind of bad rooms 45 weeks a year, you're on the road.
Is that after expenses?
After expenses, yeah. After you pay for your gas.
At least you make a profit.
Yeah, I make enough money where I can pay my child support, and I can either have a car or a house, because I also have student loans. I mean, I just lived in my car. And then I had a painting studio in downtown Ogden, and I slept up there, and then I would shower at the gym.
Wait, you slept in your car on a regular basis?
Oh, quite often. Oh, yeah, yeah.
What?
Yeah. I slept in my car. I had a tent. I'd pitch a tent. Sometimes I get campgrounds. No, I lived. It was about a period of about a year where it was family's couches, some friends' couches, my car, and my tent. If you're going to do that, this is some advice for people who are going to do this. Don't get the pup tent. What you want to do is throw in an extra 30, 40 bucks and get something that when you can stand up in it. Because it feels like a burrow. If it's a pup tent, you just feel like an animal. You just scoot in there, and it's like, and there's clothes by you. And it's really dehumanizing to not be able to stand up in your shelter. Oh. So,
where would you camp?
Washington. Remember, I camped outside of Maple Valley. I was there for about 2 weeks. Iowa, very good place to camp. Cheap, and decent showers. Horrible thunderstorms.
KOAs
from time. Those are kind of steep. They're expensive. Can't always. But state parks, yeah, in Washington, Iowa. Where else? Arkansas.
In the snow?
When it was winter, that was not a good idea. No, then it was trickier. And I've slept in the car in the snow. Man, I spent a horrible night in Wyoming. Oh, that was cold. And that was for about a year that I did that. But I was young, and I was living the dream, and I was doing, it just felt so freeing. You know, I was out doing this thing that I'd always really wanted to do, but felt I couldn't do.
When you're at some random city performing at some random club, do you hang out with the comedians before and after? Do the ladies show up and wait for you? Like, is there any social interaction, or are you just totally on your own before and after your bit?
It's incredibly lonely. Incredibly lonely. That's the other thing. And I was always kind of a loner anyway, so that fit in. But it's very lonely. What'll happen is people come to the show, but they come with their friends. And then you kind of generate this experience for them, and then they leave. Thanks, that was nice. And they go home, oh, thanks. And inside, a lot of comics are saying, you want to talk or hang out or something? but that's the young comics. Because when you're young, you will do that. You will solicit this kind of contact, you know. But it's very unhealthy and creepy and weird. And you soon learn to, like, I don't want to talk. No, don't really want to talk to a lot of you people. So you hang out with other comics. And you have this shared experience, you know. There's a camaraderie, and you hang out with them. There'll be the staff at the clubs you'll hang out with. And then some cities, there will be people I actually meet over a period of a couple of shows. They'll come back to see me. Well, you've developed a rapport. You might even go have coffee with them and talk and actually become a friend. And then it's nice. You go back to the city, and that's a friend that you will see. And that's what I do. Usually now when I go to cities, I have quite a few friends that I'm seeing in each of those cities, and quite a few familiar audience members even. So.
And are you just cold calling clubs saying, or do you get an agent?
When I first started, it was just cold calling. And I would have to...
Do you send them demo tapes or something?
Send them demo tapes. And that rarely worked. The way you got work mostly was word of mouth. Like, one comedy club owner would say, you should hire this guy, he's funny. And then they would let you in and you would do your thing. And if you're really funny, they'd bring you back. And if you're really funny, maybe they'd bump you up to headliner.
What would they pay you?
At the beginning, the features, a feature act on the road in a one-nighter in a bar where it's just, where it can be wonderful because they're happy, they're so glad to have you, or horrible because they're glad to have you there so they can crap on you. And I'm serious about that. It's just like, cool, let's just give this guy crap. And that bar, if you're the first guy, usually they have two comics in that show, and the first guy, the opener, was getting $75 a night. That's it. And so when I'm starting, they'd string four of those together. So I'm getting $300. I've got to pay my own gas. They will put you up in a hotel, but I've paid my own gas, my own food. And there's quite often 3, 4, 5 hours of driving between each of these gigs each day. So, you know, you wake up, I'm living in Salt Lake, I wake up, I got to drive to Pocatello today. I do a show. The next day I wake up, I drive to Missoula, Montana. I wake up, I do a show. The next day I got to drive to Miles City, Montana. The next day I got to drive back over to Butte and then drive home.
And in the car, are you like driving and writing down
exactly.
a joke
or yes. yeah.
practicing your routine?
And a lot of it depends. Your entire drive the next day depends on the show the night before. If you have a horrible show, that next drive, there's nothing worse than a long drive after a horrible show. Just horrible. Yeah.
Can you get to the point where there are no horrible shows?
Yeah, you absolutely you can. A lot of comics are to that point where, first of all, they're only working good rooms. They're dictating the environment. The environment is huge for stand-up comedy. People, they always tend to blame the comic. They would never say, well, maybe it's, geez, the sound is horrible, or there's bad lighting, or we suck. They never say that. But you see what I mean? It's always the comic. But if you can get to that place in your career, it's easy. You've been doing it long enough. You know what works. And the venues are always nice. And you have good shows every time.
Is that kind of where you are now?
I'm kind of there, except every once in a while I have to take shows that aren't that fun, that are hard. Corporate shows can be really hard, but they pay good money, so I take them. I do them.
What do corporate shows pay?
$1,200, $1,300 is the low that I'll take. So
that's great.
Yeah.
For one show.
$1,200, I come in, I do a show. It'll be very clean. It won't be like my comedy club show. It'll be very clean and appropriate, and it'll be really funny.
So how are corporate gigs different than comedy clubs?
Corporate shows, you have to be really clean. And if you screw up, it's a big deal. That's why you get the more money, because it is a much more difficult line to walk. And that's why they're giving you those $1,000, even $2,000. I've gotten $2,000 before, and I've screwed up them before too. I've screwed up on one. I was doing a fundraiser for the blind, and I have a bit where I'm talking about being a missionary and coming to the door, and about how we can see you in the house, you know, as a missionary when you're hiding, and you won't even hide, and we can see you. We're not blind. I said that in my bit. We're not blind. And just the sight, it was horrible. I didn't acknowledge it. I just didn't know what to do. It was just this hole, and they came back after a little while, but that was a big, horrible, horrible thing. We're not blind. Oops. And then, I'd never thought of it as any other context, I don't think it really was disrespectful. But in that one, it was like, hello, we got the glasses. What are you doing? Room full of canes. Hello. Are you blind? What are you? Are you sure? It was horrible.
So the worst is you just won't get invited back, right? Or word of mouth.
That's pretty much the worst. I would bet there are comics who've had stop payments on checks and those kinds of things. Because comics are a mess. I mean, comics, it'll do it to you. It's they were a mess to start with, you know.